Good morning.
Morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and titles for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It had been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It had been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It had been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that they're Lord's meaning and God's meaning. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there letter J in the English language to some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abide within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine vision and understood in divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given in the salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or the so-called laws of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Six is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seven is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save being the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in a newer state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is Speak the Truth. We have a prayer this morning by Dr. Will Williams and a selection of music and a scripture lesson on Mark the second chapter by Dr. Kenway Kleisman.
It's up here. Let's turn on.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Let us all bow our hearts and our minds. Oh, Father Yahweh, we are most graciously thankful to be gathered here again today to learn more of your purpose and your plan, and in accordance to your divine pattern. We humbly ask that you just pour out more knowledge and more importantly, an understanding in these last days and times, so that we may be able to stand before you in that last day without spot, without blemish. And we just simply ask that you search our hearts and prepare us and make sure that we stand right and clear in your eyesight. These are little things we ask, and other things you see that we stand in need of. In the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah, let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Are you going to zoom out?
Why did you Good
morning, class.
Good morning.
It's good to see you all this morning. I'll be reading
Mark 2.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible edited by A.B. Traina of the Scripture Research Association, and reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Mark the second. And again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noise that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them. No, not so much as about the door, and he preached the word unto them. And they come unto him, bringing one sick with paralysis, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the paralytic lay. When Yahshua saw their faith, he said unto the paralytic, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, Why doth this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but Elohim only? And immediately, when Yahshua perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, Why reason you these things in your hearts? Whether is it easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Arise, and take up thy bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, he saith to the paralytic, I say unto thee, Arise, and take up thy bed, and go thy way into thine house. And immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified Yahweh, saying, We never saw it on this fashion. And he went forth again by the seaside, and all the multitude resorted unto him, and he taught them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphae, sitting at the receipt of custom, and said unto him, Follow me. And he arose and followed him. And it came to pass that as Yahshua sat at dinner in his house, many publicans and sinners sat also together with Yahshua and his disciples, for there were many, and they followed him. And when the scribes and Pharisees saw him eat with publicans and sinners, they said unto his disciples, How is it that he eateth and drinketh with publicans and sinners? When Yahshua heard it, he saith unto them, They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And the disciples of John and of the Pharisees used to fast, and they come and say unto him, Why do the disciples of John and the Pharisees fast, but thy disciples, fast not? And Yahshua said unto them, Can the children of the bride chamber fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. For the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, and then shall they fast in those days. No man also seweth a piece of new cloth on an old garment, else the new piece that filled it up taketh away from the old, and the tear is made worse. And no man putteth new wine into old skins, else the new wine doth burst the skins, and the wine is spilled, and the skin will be burst. But new wine must be put into new skins. And it came to pass that he went through the feet white, and it came to pass that he went through the feet wheels on the Sabbath day, and his disciples began as they went to pluck the heads of wheat. And the Pharisees said unto him, Behold, why do they on the Sabbath day that which is not lawful? And he said unto them, Have you never read what David did when he had need and was hungry, he and they that were with him? How he went into the house of Yahweh in the days of Abiathar the high priest, and did eat the showbread, which is not lawful to eat before the priests, and gave also to them which were with him. And he said unto them, The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore the Son of Man is master also of the Sabbath. That was Mark 2. Let us all say
Amen.
Our first speaker this morning will be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Before I get started, we had some adjustments in the schedule for the month of March. Rebecca's going to be out of town, her and Ethan, next week, so she's not going to be up next week. Lisa's going to go up the last week of March.
The
18th?
I'm supposed to go the 18th.
That would be the 3rd, right?
Okay, do you want me to switch?
The third, that's the 3rd week of March. That's in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 2 weeks from
two
now.
Weeks.
Okay, and then you would do the 4th, okay. And that means that myself or Will would do something next week. Otherwise, he can just take it next week. Either way, it doesn't matter. But either way, you can take it next week?
Yeah,
okay, you'll do the moderation next week. So Reggie will be up to follow up next week, today. And then Lisa going to be up on the 18th. And Rebecca will be up the last week, I think, of the 25th of the month, if I'm not mistaken. That sounds right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's going to be the schedule. Now, I wasn't sure what I wanted to talk about, but then I wasn't sure if I wanted to get into Yahshua, which is a very simple subject matter. But then I decided that I'm in the mood to talk about the devil. And I'm going to keep it very simple. And the reason for that is that people have a problem understanding, you see, how the devil operates or how the adversary operates in our daily life. And that we have this myth going on, you see, is that the devil has control over these bodies, which is not so. And what my goal is trying to get you to see who you are, you see, and how Yahweh is controlling this entire purpose. That is the mystery of iniquity as well as the mystery of righteousness. However, if you don't understand both mysteries, then you're going to be tricked and duped and tossed to and fro from every wind of doctrine. Example, if you know how to add, you don't know how to subtract, then you're in trouble, correct? You see, if all you know how to do is add, and you don't know how to subtract, then you can get tricked and get your money. You understand what I'm saying? Well, the principle's the same here. Now, 1 Timothy 3, I'm going to lay a brief foundation before I move on and get into this for the benefit of our new ones here. My sister's here today. She's kind of new. I want to make sure she gets something before she goes home here. And go ahead and give her this book since she can't see. This is a big letter. So that's the premise. That's what we're talking about. The fall of Lucifer. That's pretty much what I'm talking about today. And that is in the garden right here. Okay? I have it.
Can you repeat that?
1 Timothy 3:16, where it says, "Great is the mystery of Yahweh." Is that what it says?
Yeah.
King James Version.
Okay.
All right.
1 Timothy 3:16, King James. "And without controversy, great is the mystery of Yahweh. Yahweh was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory."
Now, what she read was, "Great is the mystery of Yahweh." Alright? Read again. "Great is the mystery of Yahweh." Read.
"And without controversy."
Without controversy. In other words, there is no issue with Yahweh. Might be a problem with you, but there's no problem with him. Without controversy. Read on.
"Great is the mystery of Yahweh."
Read.
"Yahweh was manifest in the flesh."
Hold it right there. Now the question is, what is the mystery? Well, the mystery is this. We got a creation here. We got a creator who created a creation. He also created a creature and took up residence in him. And someone come along and told us there's a devil that's making us act a doggone fool. You follow what I'm saying? And I don't know about you guys. I ain't seen no devil the way we've been talking about it. Have anybody seen a devil with a red tail? Red suit?
Yep.
You see? I haven't seen one. If you have, show them to me. You see? So we got this myth going on, and there is an adversary in existence according to a purpose.
Right.
And it is Yahweh himself that purpose that back here in the realm of eternity. So it says, without controversy, great is the mystery. And the mystery is this. Something's happened that cannot be readily explained. We know it exists, but we can't explain it. That's what makes it a mystery. And everybody got a concept about what a devil is, who the adversary is, who Lucifer is, you see, and who Satan is. Everybody have a concept about it. You see, but you got to prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. You see, and we have an avenue. Why? Because we have a pattern by which we operate, and as you operate, move by this pattern, so does Lucifer or Satan and the devil operate by this pattern right here. Alright? Now let's read. "Great is the mystery of Yahweh." Read on.
"Yahweh was manifested in the flesh."
Read on.
"Justified in the spirit."
Read on.
"Seed of angels."
Read.
"Preached unto the Gentiles."
Read.
"Believed on in the world."
Mm-hmm.
"Received up into glory."
Now, Yahweh, who is spirit, who is both masculine and feminine within himself, he does not have to go outside of himself to create or to procreate. Yahweh within himself, you see, decided or declared that he himself would take on shape and form. You see, and this is Yahweh, you see, I'll say it like this. This is Yahweh as Elohim, who is the archetype original pattern of the universe. And he purposed back in the realm of eternity that there will be an adversary, you see, or an opposer, you see, for him. And he himself going to create that adversary himself. Let's get this straight. Lucifer, as we see him on this chart, we got him painted white here, you see, to show forth that this is a vision taking place. You see, we got this painted white here. You see, to show that there's a vision taking place on the chart. We got John on the Isle of Patmos. You see, showing forth that he too is having a vision. What do you mean? These things are going on within his consciousness. It is going on within Moses' consciousness. We got also right here at Mount Transfiguration. We got these men here looking at Yahshua the Messiah. But they are having a vision. Am I making sense?
Yeah.
So when you look at, when you're looking for Satan, you're going to see the manifestation of him. You see, but you're going to also see him right here within your consciousness. If that's, if you understand what I'm saying. In other words, somebody can walk through the door and they look like they looking crazy. You can say something's wrong with him. You see the body, but you also know there's something wrong within their heart and their mind. You may not know exactly what it is, but you know there's an issue or there's a problem. You understand what I'm talking about? Now. Now let me have real quickly, since we're here, let me have just a few premises. I want Ezekiel 28 chapter, but I also want Isaiah 14 and 12. And then we're going to go back over here into Revelations, the 12th chapter, about the 8th verse. And then I want to go into the textbook and draw a few more principles out. All right? Let's pick up first Isaiah 12 and 8, 14 and 12. Now, we've been instructed, all right, to go to the law and to the prophets.
Right.
You see, we know that Moses is the writer of the first five of your five books of your Bible, and from Joshua on down to Malachi are the prophets that's been drawn out, you see, from Moses. Whatever is written in the prophets, it comes from the law of Moses. And the law of Moses confirmed with the prophets, and the prophets is confirming what Moses said.
Right.
Here come Yahshua Messiah at the end of the age, listen, after his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit, he took off the covers.
Yeah.
He unlocked the mystery. Now we know what happened in that garden. We know what happened in the creative age. We understand what happened in the post and the antediluvian age. And also we understand what's happening in the post-diluvian age. And if you understand what happened in the post-diluvian age, the antediluvian age, and the creative age, it's crystal clear what's going on in the present kingdom age where you sit. If I'm making any sense here. Read, please.
Isaiah 14 and 12.
Read, talking about Lucifer. Go ahead.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground?
Hold it. Give me 14. Give me 12. And give me 11. And give me 15.
15?
Yes. Put it right up here. For me, please. Now put 11 before 15. And put your socks on before your shoes. In order. There you go. There you go. There you go. You got the tippy toes. Okay. We're good. And I probably should. And I think I will. I can't see that far. 13. I think I'm going to throw 13 in here too. All right. Now, let me say this before I go on. All these charts we're looking at, they're on the Moses chart, and it's also on the elementary chart. We say the 40-plate chart, and some people get intimidated by it. But it's the same chart that we talk about all the time. It's just like a clip, you see, from one area. Like you look here, you can see Elohim, and you see the tabernacle, and you see a man here. So we just take a clip of this, you see, and we made a chart out of it. You got the tabernacle, you got the man, which is likened to the creation coming in, and then here you are a manifestation of that. But the point is, it's just a drawn-out explanation of all of that. Am I making sense here?
Yeah.
All right, now let's read, please.
Isaiah 14 Isaiah 14 and 12.
Yes, please.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of Elohim. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Now look, this is play 14 here. Now be mindful of this. Before this creation come in, Lucifer existed, that is, in the angelic host. Because Yahweh took on shape and form, and within him, listen, that is the angelic host, or the angelic creation, and the physical creation. And in other words, when you see the cloud, you see, that's like the pure spirit. Then Yahweh Elohim appears within the cloud, and he's standing on the earth. You see, he just appears within the cloud. In other words, Yahweh himself, as he's taken on shape and form, he's coming from behind the veil of inscrutability. Now you can see him, not physically, but in by way of a vision.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Now, but remember, as a cloud, he chose to symbolize a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud, but he is symbolized as a cloud for you when you see him in a vision. Am I making sense here? So therefore, Yahweh purposed and declared within himself there will be a creation, but there also will be an adversary. You see? And this is him. You see? The angelic and the physical creation right within himself.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when Moses was called up into this mountain right here, the man Moses was made to see how the creation was assembled by a pattern. The pattern being the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, that is in an abstract state. Something that you cannot see, that you cannot comprehend, that is in his pure spirit state or in his abstract state. And Yahweh knew that and he understood that. So it behooved him, you see, to move from one state condition to the next. That is from the abstract. From the pure spirit state, whereby he's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible to the natural senses, you see, and take on a shape and form as Yahweh, which is a spirit embodiment, being made up of these attributes of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength, making up this spirit man right here. This is Yahweh in his creative state or in his I will be state. Moses is watching this as Yahweh is coming and putting this thing together. And remember, Yahweh declared this, that is, in the realm of eternity. You see? And but when he stepped out of that cloud, he is a declaration of what Yahweh purposed, that is, back here in the realm of eternity. And as Moses is being a witness, you see, to this shape and form, he is not only a party to this, but also Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu is also seeing the same shape and form. However, they don't have an understanding of the shape and form, and neither does Moses at this particular time. Then the 70 elders are also a witness to the shape and form. They don't understand the shape and form, but they did in fact see the shape and form as Yahweh Elohim. You see, it was Moses was told to come up a little bit higher, you see, not only to the plateau of the mount, but to the apex or to the top of the mount, whereby not only is he going to see the shape and form, he see the power of transmutation, how that Yahweh, being in an abstract state within himself, takes on shape and form. You see, or move from an abstract into the incorporeal. Then Moses witnessed how that this tabernacle pattern, you see, being threefold, having a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about, is no more than a manifestation or an intangible sanctuary of the spirit man, which is Yahweh Elohim himself. This tabernacle is an explanation of the shape and form. The shape and form is a manifestation of pure spirit or Yahweh and his abstractness or in his ontological state of perfection, if you will. But when he comes down, that is, out of the pure spirit state into an incorporeal state, that is an absolute death. That's the true crucifixion. You see, and now his purpose is set in motion. Or Yahweh Elohim is an execution of the purpose where Yahweh purposed and declared, that is, back here in the realm of eternity. Now that he's transformed, you see, into this tabernacle, or he shows Moses how he transmutes into this tabernacle, what are you talking about? Transmutation is abstract, intermediate, or incorporeal, and into a concrete state. So you got abstract, intermediate, and concrete. You see, that is in the realm of eternity. Or you have abstract, intermediate, you see, and concrete. Talking about the creation as it's being witnessed as Moses is seeing this in a vision.
Yeah.
Now, be mindful of the fact. Moses has no clue where the creation come from. He doesn't know where the animals come from. He doesn't know where the water come from. He don't know squat. In other words, he's just like me and you. He's in the same state and condition we're in, that is in darkness. To a creator, to the soul, to the creation, relative to its origin. Where it come from? We breathe in air and all. He don't know nothing about that. All he knows is he is that he exists. And at the end of the day, I'm sorry to tell you. Yeah. Everybody's mind is corrupt. And so is Moses. You see, because they were all worshiping idols. Come on, folks. Lord can come in here and sell me this jar with all these blocks in here for $20. And then I can put it over here and paint it and say we're going to start giving all praises. What's on here?
Biscottis.
Is that Noonies? Nunnies? Whatever it is, we're going to give all praises and homage to this
Biscottis.
I don't even know what that is. But the point is cookies.
Yeah,
and we're going to bow down to that. Now, you know, good well, this jar did not create no creation and did not bring you in. But however, if this was Buddhist in here, we all bowing down, burning candles, you see, praising. And this is what we do, showing our ignorance because somebody told us. And I'm letting you know, this Bacardi jar did not create a creation. But this is where we are. So we got all these different religions, organizations, and sects that we have embraced as mankind, and we want to fight tooth and nail about who's right and who's wrong without any proof. However, the founder said this, the problem with us as a people is that we fail to do a detailed investigation that is about important matters relative to our souls. You see, now we'll go down to the Chevrolet, one of these car dealers. We'll look under the hood and kick the wheels. You know what I'm saying? We check it out. But when it comes to our soul, we just take for granted so-and-so knows because he got a collar wearing backwards.
Right.
You follow me? So therefore, back to this, Moses is a witness to Yahweh Elohim, who is the creator of heaven and that is earth.
Right.
You see, and we found out through Moses that there is a pattern that is in operation. Now this pattern, you see, is going to be helpful. You can put this pattern on the righteousness of Yahweh as well as the unrighteousness. In other words, Lucifer is also functioning, that is, by the pattern, by the dictates of Yahweh Elohim himself.
Right.
He is not operating as a separate independent entity, you see, but he's being governed, that is, by the spirit, by the shape and form of Yahweh Elohim himself. Now let's just get this understood. You are not going to ever see Yahweh,
right,
the Father, who is pure spirit. Why? It's likened to the air in the room. You can't see it, but you know it exists.
Right.
You see, but you can see Yahweh Elohim,
right,
as he appeared within the cloud or within the consciousness that is of Moses. As Yahweh took him back, we say that what you're looking at, you see, or what he showed Moses was a recapitulation or a rerun of how the creation come in, that is by the pattern.
Right.
The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in an abstract state, taking on shape and form as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit as the Son, and then manifested as the creation or the pattern, whereby everything is threefold, having a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about, a separating of the life and the darkness with the twilight and the mist. You understand what I'm saying? The water above and the water beneath with the firmament and the mist. Everything is threefold. That's why you got these plates like this, all the way down to the man who is spirit, soul, and body. Y'all with me so far? So Yahweh is showing Moses how the creation, everything you see, everything you don't see, everything that's known, unknown, visible, invisible, animate or inanimate, it has its origin, it has its beginning, it has its start place. That is with Yahweh himself. That's not going to change. And the only way we're going to understand where all this come from, who we are and how we behave, that is that Yahweh himself reveals it to you. Right. Just as he revealed it to Moses, he had to also reveal it to you. Now, there are not different spirits in manifesting each and every one. No, there ain't but one spirit. There is no two spirits. There is not a spirit for the devil and a spirit for you.
Right.
And a spirit for you and a spirit for you and a spirit. Talk about my spirit. My spirit is your spirit. You know how we talk. And my spirit tells me this, and my spirit tells me that. Well, where you get it from? Now, let me just say this something to you. Let me say a little something about your spirit. How many have 1 Corinthians 6:19? I think that's what I want. Let me tell you something about your spirit. Who do you think you are? See, because of your carnality. See, we got steps in our tabernacle here. We got the gate being one. You see, because you got to come in. You see, and you got the altar sin sacrifice being two. You see, where the sacrifice was placed on the altar. The high priest would put the blood on the four horns of the altar because death goes to the four corners of the earth, and this altar represents the earth. And then you got the brazen laver, which is the third step in your tabernacle, where there's water representing the oceans and the seas and the lakes and things of that nature. And then you got the cup of holy anointing oil, which is actually at the door itself. The high priest would pour the oil on himself, you see, or over his head, whereby it anointed him, you see, to operate in the most holy place and the holy place. Nevertheless, it is at the door and it represents spirit. The door in reality is actually this first departmental veil, being blue, purple, and scarlet. You see, and it's parted where you can see it and you can see movement that is in your tabernacle right here. You see, and all the contents or all the vessels that is in, you follow me, the holy place, you see, represents your fifth step. That is the seven branch golden lampstand. That is also your table of shewbread, whereby it has six loaves on one side and six on the other side. Those 12 loaves representing the 12 tribes of Israel. It was a four-sided structure, but it also had a crown that would go around it. You see, the seven branch golden lampstand, of course, had seven prongs. You see, but the high priest would also put oil, that is, in the fourth branch. And that fourth branch, you see, as he put the oil in, it would just fill each one of these prongs evenly all the way up, having one light. And that light would burn around all night, because it would light at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It would burn all night to 9 o'clock in the morning, and they would snuff it out. You see, and he would dress it, getting it ready for the evening sacrifice. Everybody with me so far? And then, of course, you have the altar of incense with the high priest. Now, this looks like a four-sided structure, but it's a five-sided structure. And the high priest, you follow me, he would make the incense, you see, would waft up into the holy place to prevent Yahweh from smelling the stench of those animals, you see, that's being sacrificed, you see, on this altar. Because when you burn flesh, come on, folks, it stinks. You follow me? And so, therefore, Yahweh have this mechanism within you that when you eat your chickens and your cows and your pigs and putting your hot sauce on it, you follow what I'm saying? That when you eat it and it's being broken down in your stomach, you see, or in your digestive tract, it perfumes your body. whereby you don't smell, you see, the mechanism that's taking place, that is, in your digestive system as it's being broken down. The only time you experience what's going on in your stomach is that when it's coming out of the body, and that's when you know it's rough. Nevertheless, that's what the altar of incense is for. It walked up into the most holy place to provide a sweet-smelling savor to Yahweh to prevent the stench of these animals being sacrificed on this altar. Your sixth departmental veil is here. Not here, but it is up here. It's your second departmental veil, which is your sixth step in your tabernacle. It has a veil on top and the bottom. On the top, the two sides, and this is covered up. The only reason this is here is to show you, we have it parted so you can see what's going on within the tabernacle. But in reality, you follow me? Assuming that this is the whole most holy place, it is covered up. You can't see what's behind it. You follow what I'm saying? You see, until Yahweh allow you to tear that veil down. But until then, you don't know what the heck going on. You can see what's going on in the holy place and the court round about, but definitely not there. You with me so far? Now, we got that out of the way. My point is, this is a pattern that is of heavenly things. You see, it is not of man, but it is of every heavenly thing. And everything in the universe moves and operates by the dictates of this tabernacle pattern. And we got to get that understood. And we got it drawn out on this chart how that we call it the EMP chart. You know, the egotistical misdirected personality showing forth the natural or the physical or the carnality, but we also saw the reality or the spirituality. You see, this is righteous, this is unrighteousness, if that makes any sense. This is incorporeal. You see, I'm going to say it like this. Let me keep it simple. This is spirituality or reality. This is carnality or flesh. You see, and what this is here, when you understand it, it's a reflection of your image. You know how we are. You know, I got a bald head because I don't want to, you know, show off my gray hair. All right? Vanity. All right? That's my image. You see? And so, I just use me. It's easy to use. You see? But your senses, I'm talking about the sight, the touch, the sound, the taste, and the smell, this is what gets you in trouble. Because you like what you like and you want when you want, and these senses, you see, inspire you, you see, to reach for and to satisfy your flesh, you follow me, and your image. And at the end of the day, it's what makes you corrupt, you see, because you want to take the corruptible, you see, and put on the incorruptible. It's the incorruptible that identifies and point out what the incorruptible is. You see, it shows you the reality of who you are and how you're functioning and how you operate. That is, once you embrace the Holy Spirit or the law of spirit, at the end of the day, you see, the Holy Spirit or the law of spirit, it is the animating life force of mankind and everything that exists in this stellar universe. And everybody with me so far? All right. Now, what was I? I had a scripture. Keep reading down in Isaiah. Oh my goodness.
First Corinthians.
This is for you talking about you got talking about your spirit.
Right.
Read please.
6:19.
Uh-huh.
Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit?
Is that 6:19? What?
Yeah.
What?
Read. 1 Corinthians 6:19.
What? Bible.
Know you not that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit?
Well, go back and read that again, because we didn't hear all that.
Wait.
What? Now, Paul is beside himself. He says, what?
What?
Don't you know this? Read.
What? Know you not that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you?
Uh-huh.
Which you have of Elohim, and you are not your own?
Now, when you get talking about your spirit, well, my spirit this and my spirit that. That's what I'm trying to get you to see. Women may think that this is mine and I can do whatever I want with this body. You're going to do whatever Yahweh dictates. You see, and let me say this and I'm going to move on because I'm going to be wasting my time. You see, what you don't understand is that there is a purpose in operation. You see? And Yahweh already set this up. You see, he got the positive he got the negative.
Mm-hmm.
You see, he already made provisions. If you want to do right, be obedient, guess what? You're going to get a reward over here. Mm-hmm. That is on the right side or the positive. If you want to, you see, transgress and be disobedient, guess what? I made provisions for you as well. Therefore, you see, you might spend your life in jail. You see, do whatever you do up in there. You see, but the point is, whatever provision you like, keep comfortable either way. The founder said it like this: if you want to go to heaven, I help you get there. If you want to go to hell, I help you get there too. Don't make me no difference either way. I'm comfortable. I made provisions for both of y'all.
Well, I'm on your side.
All right. So that's that. Now, keep reading over there in Isaiah. Quickly, please. Well, not quickly, but you know what I mean. Start at 14. You can go 12 and read down. And have Ezekiel ready to go, 28th chapter, 12th verse or 11th verse. 12th verse.
Start again with how art thou fallen?
Please.
Isaiah 14 and 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, mm-hmm. son of the morning?
Read.
How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nation?
Read.
That thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of El.
Read.
I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north.
Now hold it right there. He said he's going to exalt what?
I will exalt my throne above the stars of El.
Why did he mention the stars? See, the stars is the type of the angelic host. And just as there's a multiplicity of stars, there are the multiplicity of angels. And the only reason, see, we understand that is this. Yahweh said this, because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. Why? Because he showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him, which are the attributes. For the invisible things of him from the creation world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. Even his eternal power and supernal nature, being the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, therefore you are what? Without excuse. So he said, for the invisible things of him, talking about the attributes, are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. He made or created a creation. He gave us a pattern before he brought the creation in to show us that everything is threefold. So therefore, he created the tabernacle with the most holy place, the holy place in the court round about, but it's one tabernacle. He made the man spirit, soul, and body. You see, having head, chest, and abdominal region, but the man functioned as one unit. He told the man, he gave the man three things to build. The first thing he told the man to build was Noah's ark, having an upper deck, a middle deck, and a lower deck, but it's one ark. The next thing, the tabernacle, which we already discussed, being threefold. Most holy place, court round about. And then Solomon's temple, the last thing he told the man to build,
right.
You see, was have a porch, a oracle, and a sanctuary. But it's one temple. You speak past, present, and future, no other way. The atom has a proton, a neutron, an electron, but it is one atom. Trying to get you to see that everything is moving by a pattern. Things are either upside or right side up, sideways, you see, or upside down. There is no other way because everything must reflect me. I don't care what it is. There are three parts of speech. Isn't that correct? What are they? Past, present, future. It is past, present, and future. That's it. That's the only way we speak. Why? Because everything is governed by this pattern. And everything must reflect him. So, we got an adversary. Alright? We got it up here on the chart. Satan, Lucifer, the devil. Alright? A threefold principle, or a threefold principle, or entity, if you will. You see? Now, he's Lucifer up here that is in heaven. Now, for some basic principles. Has that been going on all this time?
Yes, it has.
That's worse than the high priest, huh? Y'all should have said something to me.
Pomegranate.
Anyway, here you go. See, this says angelic invisibility. What do you mean? Now, this is a pictorial illustration to try to show you what angelic invisibility is. Now, if you were to look at this cloud over here, You see, the only reason you would never know this is intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength, or the attributes, we got them painted up here. You understand? Otherwise, you wouldn't know what that is.
Right.
Likewise, we got air in the room. You still don't know what the elements are. We know there's elements in it, but we don't know the composition of the elements. You still don't know what the composition is. We just know it's in there because science proved that there was hydrogen, oxygen, CO2, and nitrogen in the air. That's what we know. You see, but the composition of that, we don't know. That's likened to the cloud. At the end of the day, I'm trying to get you to see. You see, that Yahweh Elohim, see, when this angel is in the midst of the cloud, you cannot see him. That is angelic invisibility.
Yeah.
But when he begins to deal with you, you see, whether you're conscious of it or not, that is angelic visibility. The point is this. Lucifer had the ability and the skill and the tools to transform into an angel of light and make you think everything is all right. You follow me? But it ain't all right. But you think it's all right because you feel good.
Right.
You see, seduction feels good.
Right.
Male or female, you can say no all you want and you flow right with it.
Right.
That's why folks get in trouble when they say, well, you know, she was saying no. She was saying no, but she was flowing right with it. And they say, well, no means no. Sometimes no doesn't mean no. You know that.
That's right.
But when things don't go right, you say, well, I told you no.
Yeah.
Don't act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Oh. Everybody knows exactly what I'm talking about. No does mean no. You see, but your manifestation tells us what no is and what no isn't. Y'all with me so far? So I'm trying to get you to see here, you see, in the cloud, Lucifer, you see, when he comes from behind the veil of inscrutability, he's coming down or making a descent, which we're going to draw that out in a minute, you see, because he has to get cast out of heaven, you see. But when he's up here in the midst, you see, in the most holy place, according to the pattern, according to our pattern right here, you see, he is behind the veil because this is covered up. You see, now, let's get this straight. There's only one sitting on the throne. That is Yahweh Elohim himself. Yahweh is always sitting on the throne. Now, this is what I'm talking about. When Moses made this tabernacle pattern, maybe we should just get it. Exodus, the 34th chapter, I think I want about the 40th verse. Or is the 40th verse... It's the 40th verse and the 34th chapter. Make that 40th chapter, 40 and 33. Exodus 40 and 33. All right? Now, we have to look at Moses to get an understanding of what's going on with our pattern, right? Now, Yahweh gave Moses divine specification on how to build and construct this tabernacle. Yahweh already made it. And see, and then the creation came in 7 days, and then, you see, Yahweh Elohim entered his rest. Now, after, you see, Yahweh finished creating creation, he entered his rest. For the next 33 days, Moses received divine specifications on how to build and construct this tabernacle pattern. You see, that is before he came down out of the mount, that is on his second trip. Then went up Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 elders, and they saw the elder of Israel. And under his feet, as it were, a page work of a sapphire stone, and the body of heaven in its clearness. And upon the nose of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. So we know that Elohim had feet, body, and hand, and he is Moses witnessing how he's standing on the airplane. He received the vision, that is, you see, in 7 days, or in 6 days, how he assembled the creation, and then Yahweh entered his rest, and then he received divine specification on how to build and construct that tabernacle, which Yahweh wrote in his heart and in his mind, or within his consciousness. He didn't walk down with no structure or no blueprint. He himself was that as he's writing in his heart and in his mind. And as he's coming down out of the mountain right here, you see, these people corrupted themselves by building this golden calf. You see, and when they built this golden calf right here, Moses waxed hot, threw these table stones down, because he realized these people transgressed, you see, the law of corporal ordinances that Yahweh gave the children of Israel, which you read about in the book of Exodus, the 20th chapter. They built the golden calf and said, let this be the Yahweh that brought us up out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, their minds were corrupt. And they broke every tenet of that law that Yahweh just spoke down from that law. And he wrote that law, you see, on the table stone with his finger. Three laws on one side, seven on the other. The three representing the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and the seven representing the 7 days of creation. In that we got a pattern, we got seven steps in our tabernacle, is that right? Representing the 7 days of creation, but we got the most holy place, the holy place, and a court roundabout, of course, representing, you see, the other laws on the three sides. So that's why you got three on one side and seven on the other. You see, that's the proof and that's the witness to that. You see, now, and the other thing, before I go on with that, just as a witness within you, you have a pituitary gland. You got three laws on one side. You got seven on the other. You got three on the anterior, and you got seven on the posterior lobe. You see, and that law, that's your pituitary gland, says whether you're going to have a big head or a little head, blue eyes, green eyes, blue eyes, big ears, little ears. You get my point? Big feet, little feet, brown hair, black hair, red hair, blonde hair, whatever. It's your pituitary gland that governs that. It's the master gland that is of your creation, you see, or your earthly body, you see, or your miniature construction of the universe. That's what's governing you. So therefore, spirit law has to govern you. It governs you here because it's governing them. So if it governs your physical body, can't you see that it also has to govern Israel? You see? Now, this is after Moses had finished building the tabernacle and there's nothing in it. It's like somebody you know that's dead out there in the cemetery, or when you get here and you got no spirit in you. You all with me so far? Mm-hmm. Read.
Exodus 40 and 33. And he raised up the court all around the tabernacle and the altar.
Read.
And hung up the screen of the court gate.
Read.
So Moses finished the work.
So he finished building the tabernacle. Let's read.
Then the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle.
Now the glory of Yahweh, you see, the cloud comes in, it goes in, and it sits on the mercy seat. Read on.
And Moses was not able to enter the tabernacle of meeting,
mm-hmm.
because the cloud rested above it, and the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle.
Read.
Whenever the cloud was taken up from above the tabernacle,
mm-hmm.
the children of Israel would go onward in all their journeys.
Read.
But if the cloud was not taken up,
uh-huh.
then they did not journey till the day that it was taken up.
Read.
For the cloud of Yahweh was above the tabernacle by day, and fire was over him by night,
mm-hmm.
in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all their journeys.
Now, we're not going to read over that today. We always do. Just that last verse you read, I want you to pick that up one more time, and I need you, Kingway, to go over to Exodus, the 24th chapter, and pick up, the 24, pick up 16, and hold it right there. But we ain't going to read over this today. Now go back and read that last verse again. Don't read over this.
Exodus.
Now look, Moses is having a vision.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
And
Moses goes in a tabernacle, makes sure that the mercy seat is, everything is proper, because Yahweh gave him divine specification. He's looking around, making sure that the curtains are proper. You see, the pillars and the boards, is he coming out? He's checking out the lampstand. He's checking out the doggone table of shewbread. You see, that all the forks and knives and spoons and all that stuff is in position. I'm talking about in a tabernacle. You see, and he's walking out. You see, he's coming through the door. The veil, they ain't got no rips in it, no marks on it. You follow what I'm saying? Everything is perfect up in there, and as he's coming on out, you see, he sees the labor, he checks it out, makes sure the spick is there and everything, you understand? And he's coming on out, he's looking at the altar, he sees everything is cool. You see, and he see all the drapes, you see, the curtains all up. You see, and when it was complete, it's the same thing as when you come to your mother's womb. That is, after 40 weeks or 280 days, your spirit law or Yahweh himself takes up residence in you, and then you begin to move and animate, that is, on the earth. Likewise, Yahweh entered into that tabernacle, and he sat, that is, on the throne. Now, if Lucifer had this, any chance to be sitting on the throne, he's going to do it before Yahweh get up in there. Y'all follow what I'm talking about? You see, and listen, before you get here, ain't nobody sitting on the throne for this reason. Only Yahweh himself knows how to animate and create a body. Lucifer does not know how to animate, neither does he know how to create a body. Why? He did not have permission. If that be the case, there'd be a whole lot of Lucifers and devils running around here. You see, period. Yahweh made provision for him, and he placed him in darkness. You see, so therefore, when he cast him out of heaven, talking about Lucifer, you follow what I'm saying? He cast him out, and it was Michael that cast him out. You see him right here. You see, this angel, you see, with that flame. You see, and you got Lucifer having a 666 right on him as he's coming down. So he's coming out of the most holy place, whereby it's a type of pure spirit, being incomprehensible and inscrutable and indiscernible, almost like when you first get here as a baby. You see, and then as you cast out, that is, into the holy place, it's a division between invisibility and visibility. Now, that's what we're after today. Is it the division between invisibility and visibility? We'll talk about that in a minute. And as he's out, and as Lucifer is being cast out, these angels, they followed him out. Yahweh didn't put them out. They followed him out. Yahweh put Lucifer out because he got puffed up, arrogant, exalted within himself that he thought he was the man. So Yahweh had to show him that he was Yahweh Elohim and it's not you. So he cast him out. You know how the lions do on when you watch YouTube. I know y'all have to watch. Well, those two lions say, hey, you know what? I need to take over your house. He said, well, you got to fight me to get it. When he fight me to get it, guess what? He leaving one come, right? That's how it works. What else was happening right here? The point is, this was no contest. Yahweh already set up the fight. And he already knew it was going to happen. But look here, folks. Yahweh cast this bad boy out. He also knew that these angels would follow him out, and they came right on into that ethereal darkness, which means that it is a heavenly darkness. You see that little line right there? That's the earth. The problem is this. When he cast him out of the garden, talking about Lucifer, you see, he had no body to enter into. Because, see, this was the unfinished creation, you follow me, that he came into. So now we got pictures drawn here, but I'm telling you right here, it's not no angels flying around like this here and gliding like the birds that is in the realm of eternity. You know, like we see on TV, how they just, you know, swimming on. That's what we think. And see, as somebody was saying, oh, it's just a spiritual being flying around the heavens. You see, like that. You better wake up and smell a coffee. Lucifer is intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength. These attributes perverted. That's what Lucifer is. A perversion of these righteous principles. That's what he is. That's what he's always been. Yahweh set it up. He perverted. Yahweh tell the truth, establish the truth. He twisted. That's his job, to trick you and to make you think something exists that does not exist. You with me? So, but that's done by the thoughts that are within your consciousness. And like it or not, your thoughts are incorporeal. You can't see them, you can't touch them, you cannot handle them. But they exist within your consciousness. Just like you can't see your senses, you know they exist. You see, there's a physical attachment, but you cannot see it with your natural physical eyes. But Lucifer, you see, or angels are ministering spirits. You see, and every now and then, you might be in a situation, somebody may call and say something, and it just soothes your soul. You see, but Lucifer, again, is a perversion of these righteous principles, or a direct antithesis of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. So when you see Yahweh establish the truth, his mission, his job is to oppose and to lure you into that darkness and keep you in that darkness. Y'all with me so far? Now, where are we? I'm done with that. I want to get this thing about the sight. Don't read over this. Read.
Exodus 40 and 38.
Read that again.
For the cloud of the Yahweh.
What?
The cloud of Yahweh above the tabernacle by day. And fire was over it by night.
Read on. Here we go right here. Now hold it. He's talking about these children of Israel down at the base of the mount. Here they are at the plateau of the mount. But this cloud was, listen, a phenomenal cloud. It was just not any old cloud. It was a cloud that led them up out of the land of Egypt through the dividing waters of the Red Sea. And it was a light by day, that is, to the children of Israel, but it was also darkness by night, and I mean always, that is, to the Egyptians. You see? That's why we got this painted black and white right here. You see? And that cloud, there was an angel that was in the midst of the cloud that was leading the children of Israel out of Egypt through the divided waters of the Red Sea. You see? Into the waters of Sinai. And that cloud came and it set atop Mount Sinai. You see? And that's what she's reading. It was a pillar fire by night and a cloud by day. Let's read. This is what I want you to hit. Go ahead.
In the sight. How do
we, when we read that again, I want you to hit the sight. In the sight of the children of Israel, in their eyes.
In the sight of all the house of Israel.
In other words, Egypt didn't see this. The Egyptians did not see that phenomenal cloud. It was in the sight of the children of Israel that this was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. It was always darkness to the Egyptians. In the sight of the Egyptians. But in the sight of the children of Israel, it was a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day. Read.
Throughout all their journey.
Now, go in when I told you over in Exodus 24th chapter, let's read that real quick. I got to get this understood. Read.
Exodus 24:16. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
Now, let's get this understood, too. This shape and form, that's the glory of Yahweh right there. Mm-hmm. All right? This shape and form is the glory of Yahweh. And he was in the midst of the cloud. Let's read, please.
And the cloud covered it 6 days.
Read.
And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
Uh-huh.
And the sight of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mount.
I don't want you to read over that now. You see? I want you to read over that. Go back and read that again.
And the sight of the glory of Yahweh.
Now, and the sight of the glory of Yahweh. What these people saw. Read.
Was like devouring fire on the top of the mount in the eyes of the
children. In the eyes of the children of Israel. Now these people down here at the base of the mount, they didn't see that. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about the base, they didn't see that. The 70 elders, they saw the shape and form.
Yeah.
And they didn't have about you the 70 elders, and of course Moses saw the shape and form. But it was Joshua's son, the son of Nun, who was transformed as Elohim. You see, and it was Yahweh of him who was in Joshua the son of Nun. And it was Joshua the son of Nun who was up here, transformed before Moses, listen, narrating the Genesis to Moses, day by day by day, event by event. And Moses, you see, was hearing that and seeing that within his consciousness. And he sees how he draws the woman out, how the man was formed, you see, from the dust of the earth, you see, and the man became a living soul, you see, and here he's placed in the garden right here, you see, but it is Yahweh Elohim made manifest. He'll summon creation, form the man from the dust of the earth, man be both masculine and feminine within himself, because Yahweh is both masculine and feminine, as well as Yahweh Elohim is both masculine and feminine. Therefore, the purpose was declared in the realm of eternity, so when Yahweh Elohim appeared within the cloud, the purpose moved, you see, or transmuted into, of course, Yahweh Elohim, or the purpose moved, you see, from one state of condition to the other. So therefore, when Yahweh Elohim took up residence in Adam, that is now the purpose encounter with Adam, or the kingdom is that an encounter with an Adam, or the kingdom is now on earth. Whatever one do you, it should satisfy your flesh. You see, that's what happened. So when you read about the kingdom that's not on earth, this kingdom, now he's on earth because he's cloaked, that is, in a body. You see, or in a veil, which is Yahweh Elohim forming his own creation and forming, creating his own body that is fitted exactly for him in the face of Adam. All right? Now, so he made the man spirit, soul, and body. And the man was made in his image after his likeness, the shape and form. And Dr. Kinley said it like this, that the man was a photostatic copy, that is, of Yahweh Elohim. So now, we got the man, you see, in the garden, you see, and he's alone by himself at this particular time. Now, real quickly, I think I got the thing straight about the eye, the sight. My point is, in the sight of the children of Israel, they're the ones that saw this phenomenal cloud. The Gentiles around them, they did not see that. That's what I want understood. They too were having a vision, just as Moses was having a vision. That's what I want you to understand. Now, back to Isaiah, then Ezekiel, and then we're going to get into the Genesis.
I ain't got to check the book yet.
Read.
Isaiah,
where were we? 14. Start at 14 and you're on down.
14.
Well, pick up where it says it's going to be in the side of the north.
14 and 13. Yes, I said in my heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of El.
So he wanted to exalt himself above Elohim. Hey, it's not enough to be like him. He wanted to exalt himself above the throne. Yeah. Above the throne. Read, please.
I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation on the sides of the north.
Now, the reason why I said the sides of the north, because Dan means judgment. So therefore, Lucifer want to or desire to sit on the seat of authority, or the judgment seat, which Yahweh Elohim sits on. And that is on a regular basis. Read, please.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Read on.
Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell.
That's enough right there. Now head over to Ezekiel real quick.
Ezekiel 28.
Yes, please.
The word of Yahweh came to me again, saying,
read.
Son of man, say to the prince of Tyre, thus says Yahweh Elohim, because your heart is lifted up, and you say, I am an Elohim, I sit on the seat of Elves, in the midst of the seas, yet you are a man, and
look,
not
look,
a man.
You read that up?
I'm sorry, I got a new Bible.
You got a new Bible?
Yeah.
That's why I don't like reading these new Bibles.
Yeah.
They messed up the flow.
Okay.
You know what I mean? You know how somebody cooks some nice, you know, some people cook macaroni and cheese and greens, or whatever cuisine it is, you know what I mean? And the only reason you keep going back to that restaurant or place because it's so good, it always tastes the same way. You follow me? But then you go, you get a new cook, and they're going to call themselves Spikers. He said, who cooked today? You see? Or you have a Thanksgiving dinner and say, who cooked today?
Okay.
You see? You know, the dressing tastes different this year than it did last year. Who made it?
Yes, sir.
You get my point? Yeah. And see, that's why we like to use the Holy Name Bible, so we all read out the whole name. Or you need to read, get a King James Version, or a Scofield, or a Zonovan. You follow me? Right, read some type of Bible that sticks. It says King James. But the new this new stuff, it takes the power out of it. What's his name? A.B. Traynor, give a little salt. You know, it says adversary rather than devil. It says punishment rather than evil. You get my point?
Yes.
Little things like that. So stay with me, please.
Here we go, man.
You jump out. What you got it for?
Ezekiel 28.
Now, Ezekiel, now watch this sound all different. That sounds foreign to me. A new recipe. Read on.
The word of Yahweh came again unto me, saying,
read.
Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyre, thus saith Yahweh Elohim,
I'm feeling good.
Thy heart is lifted up.
Thy heart is lifted up, come on.
And thou hast said, I am El.
Go ahead.
I sit on the seat of El.
Read.
In the midst of the seas, yet thou art man, not El.
Read.
Though thou set thine heart as the heart of El.
Now read on.
Behold.
Now listen, folks. He said he sits on the seat of El. He may be sitting on the seat, he may be sitting on the throne that somebody built him, appearing as the man, and they worshiping him. But he definitely ain't sitting on Yahweh's seat, because he ain't giving his seat up. And guess what? He don't have to fight. We say, Doc?
Right there, the picture. Right there.
The Pope. Oh, the Pope? Okay, yes, I see what he said. The Pope may be sitting on his seat over there in the Vatican. You see, but he ain't Yahweh. He's just posing as Yahweh. That's what Doc is saying. He's posing as a representative or a vicar, you see, of Yahweh until he returns, which he ain't coming back. That's why I always say things like, you know, you can wait on me till Jesus comes. Because believe me, he ain't coming. You follow me? Keep reading.
Behold, Thou art wiser than Daniel.
Read.
There is no secret that they can hide from thee.
Read.
With thy wisdom.
Whoa. What do you read that?
28 and 28, 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 28
and watch him. Come on, read.
Thou hast been in Eden.
Now, wait a minute. See him right here? Now, some folks don't support this principle, but I'm telling you, folks, this play came right out the textbook. I'm talking about this play right here. That folks say, that's Yahshua Messiah. That is not Yahshua Messiah. You ain't gonna read nothing about no Yahshua Messiah in the book. I'm going to tell you right now, the first time you ever hear the name Yahshua in your Bible, in the book of Exodus, and you got witnesses, is Exodus, the 17th chapter and the 9th verse. Is that right, Doc?
Yeah.
That's tell you. That's the first time you ever hear the word, and it's Joshua, yeah. You're going to read. Before that, you don't hear about it.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. You see, and listen, and let me say this. It was Moses that revealed to us who Yahshua was, because Yahweh told him about Yahshua and Elohim and Yahweh. At the burning bush.
That's right.
That don't mean we know anything about Yahshua or Moses.
That's right.
You see, and who he is, which I ain't got time to get into. But read on, please.
Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Eden.
So thou hast been in Eden. I got it right here. The garden of Elohim. Read on.
Every precious stone was thy covering.
Read. Every precious stone was. Go ahead.
The sardis, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, sapphire, emerald, and the carbuncle. Gold, the workmanship of the tabernacle.
Now, let me tell you something. Everybody taught for years, and I taught it too, that he's trying to mimic the high priest. Talk about the 12 precious stones. But see, she only quoted 9 and the gold. That's 10. You see, precious, you see, stones, you see, that Yahweh created on the earth. Let me say it like this. With the 9 and couched within the gold. The point is, he's trying to mimic Yahweh. You see, who made up of these 9 principal attributes wrapped up in the kingdom, which is 10. So there's 10 attributes that were relative, we're pointing to, but there's 9 stones and couch, of course, in the gold, just like there's 9 principal attributes and couch within Yahweh making up a 10. You with me so far? So he's trying to be like him. Can't be him, trying to be like him. So therefore, when you go here, and you look at the Tower of Babel over here, and when he builds, you see, the Tower of Babel without divine specification, talking about Lucifer, you see, when he builds it, guess who's sitting at the top of the throne? It has to be Nimrod. Because he's the one that's giving instructions, upholding Yahweh, saying, just in case Yahweh decided to destroy the earth by a flood, guess what? We're gonna be smarter than him. We're going to build a tower, and when the waters come, it will not, you see, reach higher. That high up in the heavens, that we're all drowned out. But Yahweh spoke and that tower come tumbling down because it was not built on a solid foundation. You follow what I'm saying? Let's read. But that's how Yahweh worked. Let's read.
The workmanship of thy tabrets.
Read.
And of thy pipes.
In other words, he's smooth. He knows how to talk. He knows what to say in such a way to make you do what he needs you to do because he's so suave. And he knows how to present himself. Whereby he's showing forth strength, or he's smooth, or you listening to what he's saying. You'll say, oh, he's smart. Oh, he got this. Oh, he had that. And guess what? He got your ear. I'm talking about Lucifer. And he's only using his attributes to trick you. You follow what I'm saying? Read, please.
Was prepared in thee the day that thou was created.
It was prepared in thee the day that thou was created. In the realm of eternity. Let's read.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covered.
Thou art, talking about Lucifer, he is the anointed cherub, you see, or the angel that covered. Talking about Lucifer, the 666, we are.
And I have sent thee.
I gave you that position. In other words, Lucifer was decorated, folks.
Right.
He was sharp. He was looking good. Presenting himself well. Articulating very well. You see, what Yahweh told him to say. But because Yahweh, Elohim himself, was among the angels, he was just looking like one of those Joe Blow folks, just like anybody else. But what happened, the people got the ooh and the ah and the ooh and the ah. Like, yeah. You see, he got to the point that the heck with Yahweh Elohim. It's all about me. He became exalted. You see? And when he did that, he wanted to kick Yahweh off his throne. I didn't say he did. I said he wanted to. Yahweh gave him a position. Genesis. I ain't got all day. Genesis, I think it's the 40 and 33. Real quickly. Remember, it was Yahweh that put, it was Yahweh, you see, that put Joseph down here in the land of Egypt. You see, his brother sold him into slavery. But see, he was able to,
there is no 43.
I said 40. And
Genesis. Now therefore let Pharaoh look out a man discreet and wise and set him over the land.
Now this is after Yahweh, you see, had delivered Joseph out of the prison. You see, now he just interpreted the dream for the king. You see, now the king is going to put Joseph in charge. You see? Read on, please.
Let Pharaoh do this, and let him appoint officers over the land, and take up the fifth part of the land of Egypt in the seven plenteous years. And let them gather all the food of those good years that come, and lay up corn under the hand of Pharaoh, and let them keep food in the cities. And that food shall be for store to the land against the 7 years of famine that shall be in the land of Egypt, that the land perish not through the famine.
Go ahead, read.
And the thing was good in the eyes of Pharaoh.
Now, it was good in the eyes of Pharaoh. Because Joseph, you see, interpreted his dream. Now read.
And in the eyes of all his servants.
Go ahead.
And Pharaoh said unto his servants,
read.
We find such a one as that is, a man in whom the spirit of Elohim.
He said, now we've got to find somebody with the spirit of Elohim.
In him.
Read on, please.
And Pharaoh said unto Joseph,
read.
Much as Yahweh hath told thee all that there is none so discreet and wise as thou art, thou shalt be over in my house, and according unto the word shall all my people be ruled, only in the throne will I be greater than thou.
Now that's what I want. He placed, talking about Pharaoh, he placed Joseph second in command, but he let him know that I'm running things. It's still my kingdom, but you gonna run everything. But this is, but you working for me.
42.
It says, read on, please.
And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, see, I have set thee over all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh took off his ring from his hand and put it upon Joseph's hand and arrayed him in vestures of fine linen and put a gold chain upon his neck.
That's good enough right there. Can't you see in a type how Yahweh, you see, made Joseph second in command? Mm-hmm. You see, setting him up. That when it came down for them to deliver them, because he had to send to be the messenger, the children of Israel, that Elohim will surely visit you. And they're going to be placed in a land whereby they were evilly entreated. And they were down here for some 400 years. And at the end of the 400 years, Yahweh, you see, sending, you see, his son, or let's say like this, came himself, you see, in the personality of Joshua, the son of Nun. It was down here for 30 years to deliver the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. You see, but the whole fight was not about Israel. It was about Joshua, the son of Nun, and Pharaoh himself. That's who the warfare was with. You see, it don't look like it, but it was Joshua talking to Moses, telling him what to go tell Pharaoh. You see? And he told Moses exactly what Pharaoh was going to say and what he was going to do. He said, well, when we do this, I'm going to pour out that plague. Don't worry about it. I'm going to pour out a bunch of them. I'm going to let him know who's running things down here. And that's what the people didn't see. They just say, Moses, you just all come down here messing up our flow. We had food, we had shelter, we have all this. And next thing you know, you down here messing up the whole program. These people were upset with Moses. They murmured all the time from the time they got about, from the time they was in Israel until they got all the way up here to Canaan's land. Although Moses died off, there was always one. You know how we are, folks. Always complaining about something, ain't never satisfied with nothing. No matter how much you have, you want some more, you want some more, you want some more. Alright? Now, I think I'm done with that. Where am I? Go back to where we left off. My point is, it was Yahweh setting Joseph up. Is it? But he used Pharaoh to place him in command. And I'm trying to get you to see that when he built this, the Tower of Babel, he wanted to be like the Most High. You see, but Yahweh is granting, he shut that down. And when he set Lucifer up in heaven, he gave him a position, but Lucifer lost sight of that Yahweh did that. You see, thinking he's the man when he's looking for, because he was decorated. You know how we are. Read, please.
28:14. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. And
read.
Set thee so.
Now, when he said he's the anointed cherub that covereth, he's talking about this second court, this veil here. His position is on the veil, not the seat. On the veil, not the seat. You see? And Dr. Kelly put it in his textbook on the fourth day. You see? We got Saturn. We got Saturn right there. You see, you got the arms, you got the stars on the veil, pointing to the angelic host. You got the sun, you see, and you got spirit of law, you see, which is like the Yahweh that's in the midst of the cloud. And there never have been a time, you follow me, when Lucifer was sitting on the throne of Yahweh. I'm talking about the mercy seat. Because he ain't got no mercy. See, David said this. He said, I'd rather be judged by Yahweh rather than man, because man has no mercy. But Yahweh has mercy. You follow me? Because you know how we go. We may knock somebody down, and then we want to start stumping them, carrying on. That's kind of the mentality we have. Rather than say, get up, man, let's fight some more. No, you want to make sure you don't come down, or get up no more. No mercy. Now, I think. Keep reading that.
Thou was upon the holy mountain of El.
Read.
Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire.
Read on. Now, the stones of fire is among the angels. Read on, please.
Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created, till iniquity was found in thee.
Now, he said, thou was perfect in thy ways, meaning that he was obedient. I'm talking about Lucifer was obedient to Yahweh until wickedness or the state of unequalness was found within you. When you became exalted, you see, I had to make sure you ain't gonna be running things for me because you ain't got my back. You see, so therefore, Yahweh cast him out. Now let me say this. Read that one more time, that one verse.
Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created, till iniquity was found in thee.
Now that's the origin of this thing you call a youth. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Until iniquity was found within you. It's the same thing, you know how kids are. They're so sweet and you just love them to death and can't do no wrong. Next thing you know, they do something you absolutely don't like that was abomination against all your principles. And then you see some iniquity in them. You see, and if you don't see it, somebody else saw it. And then they tell you about it, you still don't see it. You know how we are. My kids would never do nothing like that. They're the main ones doing it. You saw your kids breaking it, so-and-so. My kid was in school. Then you go check out, you find out he really was. You can't believe it. And you get my point? But that's the origin of the you, when iniquity was found within him. That's when carnality, you see, was originated. That's the point I'm trying to get you to see. And therefore, all he is, talking about Lucifer, because the word Lucifer means light bearer, but that is
you see, equal to carnality. All he is, talking about Lucifer, and when he fell, his name was changed to Satan. He was Lucifer in heaven, and when he fell, his name was changed to Satan. You follow me? That's why it says, "Oh Lucifer, how art thou fallen from heaven, son of the morning?" You see, but Satan is his name. You see, and Satan can never, ever enter back into heaven. That is, ever again. Matter of fact, Dr. Kennedy said it like this in his textbook. He says, those angels who follow Lucifer out of the garden, it is as if they never, ever existed. They have no place, you see, in the kingdom ever again. You see? And so, we always do this. That when Lucifer fell, right? He fell, and he's trying to find his way back into heaven. And guess what? He can't come back in. He got that six on him. That 666 on him. And he can never find his way back in. Because Yahweh swore against his own wrath that he will never enter back into heaven again. You with me so far? But he's going to definitely find his way in. He's going to definitely try to recruit his crew. That's us. That's why we have all these different religions and organizations, things like this. Because we all call ourselves going to heaven. Which that is another lecture within itself. Now that he's on the earth plane, talking about Lucifer, okay? Genesis 1:26. Because I don't have time to get about the warfare. But the point is, we already know that there was war in heaven, Yahweh, and Lucifer, Michael and his angel cast him out, and he prevailed not. Y'all got that point?
Genesis 1:26.
Now here we are. Go ahead.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air.
Now he gave him dominion, meaning that he was king. If there is, you see, a vegetable kingdom, and there's an animal kingdom, they got to be a ruler over the kingdom. But Yahweh gave Adam dominion over the animal kingdom as well as the plant kingdom. Read, please.
And over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth.
Go ahead.
So Elohim created man in his own image. In the image of El created he him.
Mm-hmm.
Male and female created he them. And Elohim blessed them, and Elohim said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it.
Now here he is. It says the breath of life. Yahshua breathed on the disciples. You follow me? Which we don't get to. That's in John, because what happened, when he breathed on the disciple, is like the type and the shadow of the breath of life that was airing into the man Adam.
Right.
But when people see the breath of life, you guys know good and well that spirit does not breathe. Am I right? He just stepped in the man. And what stepped in the man was the law of spirit of life, which is Yahweh Elohim himself, to animate that body. And when he animated that body, the book says the man became a living soul. And when he had a living soul, meaning this, he had all of these attributes encountered within the man. You see, and each one of these attributes are beyond the possibility of death. They are immutable principles or eternal principles and have no beginning and no ending. So when he took up residence in Adam, that life-giving force or that animating life force of Yahweh Elohim or the Holy Spirit is what animated the man Adam himself. And let's get one thing straight. This is not Yahweh over here, Elohim over here, and the Holy Spirit down there. Do you understand what I'm saying? We all get that twisted. Because we say there's Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit in the abstract state. He's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, that is, in the incorporeal state. And he's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, that is in the concrete state or the corporeal state. He never divides the union of the Spirit or the Godhead. My point is, he's not Yahweh the Father one time, but when he presents himself for the man to understand him according to a purpose, and when it's broken down, you see the Father abstract, the Son incorporeal, and the Holy Spirit concrete. Now, give you an example. Somebody dies, call a code blue. You got a policy and proceed. What you do first? A, B, C. Establish an airway. You see, you're going to breathe. You're going to start pumping for circulation. Although we change that almost every 3 to 4 years. Now you circulate first, then you breathe. You follow me? And then you just started pumping first, then you breathe. Where before we used to breathe because we thought you need air before you can breathe. You already got air in you. So you start pumping, making sure that blood is flowing throughout the body. My point is, everybody comes at the same time. The pharmacists come, the ER doc comes, the nurses come, the therapists come, the phlebotomists come. Everybody shows up at the same time, and everybody knows their role. That is, in the code blue. You with me so far? Somebody gonna put the line in, somebody's pumping, somebody's putting a tube in a throat. It's all going on simultaneously. Right. But if you have to teach it, you have to break it down. What's first? What's the most important thing? You know, in terms of prioritizing, you know, a code blue. So, first thing we always tell people do, you call for help first. Then you start pumping. You see, because you can't do it all by yourself. You get the point I'm trying to make? So, my point, there's an order. You see, how things are taking place, just like there's order within this tabernacle. Nevertheless, here the man is on the airplane. Read, please.
Whoops.
Genesis 1:27. So Elohim created man in his own image.
Read.
Image of El created he him.
Read on.
Male and female created he them. And Elohim blessed them, and Elohim said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish.
Now hold it right there. Now in the King James Version it says, and he called their name Adam. She was Adam, and he was Adam. You follow me? And here they are in the garden. So what Yahweh does, after Adam named all the animals, he saw that Yahweh, or the man, did not have a woman that was fit for the man, or a help meet, he called it, that was fit for the man. So, he puts the man in a deep sleep, you follow me? And then he draws a woman out. So, sleep is likened unto death, you see, and the woman immersed in him is likened to a burial. And then he draws a woman out, and he presents his bride to Adam, you see? And when he presents the bride to Adam, they go and they are in perfect peace. That is in the garden, you see? And then, you see this old boy right here. He said, gonna read one more verse, we're gonna get down. In Leviticus 18:8.
Leviticus 18:8.
Yeah, because see, he's back here, and he's looking at them, and his position is, well, how many bodies do they come in? You got him, you got her. Because he wasn't there before. She wasn't there before. All of a sudden, she shows up. You see? And she, believe it or not, she's the Omega. He's the Alpha. You see? So instead of him going to Adam, couldn't do that. Because he looks almost like Michael, the one who cast him out of the garden. So therefore, he proceeds towards the woman. And he woos her, and he deceives her. But what he's doing, he's coming in, that is, in the 40th day, you see, that moved Adam and Eve was in that garden. Or should I say Moses was in the garden, if you will. Let's read.
Leviticus 18:8. The nakedness of thy father's wife shalt thou not uncover.
Now listen, the nakedness of thy father's wife thou shalt not uncover. She is the bride of Adam. You see? So if you wrap his eyeball through the window, you see, or pick it through the crack of the door, you know what I'm talking about, right? You see, while somebody bathing or something, then you're spying out one's nakedness or innocence, if you will. Now, come on, folks, let's just get one of those things straight. These folks did not know nothing about no doggone clothes in the garden. And when they all come in just like any other animal, I'm telling you, they ain't ashamed. They're innocent. They're wholly innocent when they come in. Talking about the male and the female. You see? But what happened, she was weak and she was innocent. And she was looking at the doggone tree. And Elohim told Adam not to touch, not to eat. And let me tell you something. Lucifer heard it. And so she's looking at the tree and Adam is moving right by. So he goes to her. and he will lose her. But he's spying out her nakedness, because she, drawn out, is subject to vanity. Oh, man, there's so much. See, that's a good place to start next week. She is subject to vanity. So therefore, when she was in him, she was like in the law. She was protected. The same thing when a mother bore a child, carried a child for 40 weeks. He's protected in the womb. But when he comes out, he's cold. He's shivering, right? And he's hungry. But when he's in the womb, he can just sit there and eat all day long. And it's warm up in there. You see, because he's robbing the mother of her blood supply. She's anemic and he's doing all right. You see? Until he gets here, guess what? He's cold, he's shivering, they put clothes on you, they put a cap on because the heat gets out through the head. You get my point? Because you got to stay warm. And now that they're hungry. And you got to feed them. So just as Yahweh prepared victuals up in the garden for the man to eat, when you get here, there's also food for you to eat. No different. You see? But anyway, here he is, spying out her nakedness, looking at her. Read on, please.
Nine, the nakedness of thy sister.
Go back to eight.
Eight, the nakedness of thy father's wife shalt thou not uncover. It is thy father's nakedness.
Okay, my point is, it is thy father's nakedness. You might be looking at her, but it's thy father's nakedness. That was Adam's bride. Likewise, we are Yahweh's bride. So when Lucifer come to us, he know we don't know squat about Yahweh. So we start talking about Jesus and Buddha and all that stuff and Allah and all that, because we don't know nothing about Yahweh. And so they make sure they pick and choose certain ones to draw them in to that darkness. And that's why we run around fighting each other about this religion and that religion and that religion, because Lucifer, he don't change colors. He just appear differently. And he draw you into that darkness by selling you lies and deceit and making you believe it because of his conviction, folks. And because he got a collar, you see, and because it makes sense and you feel so good about it because you've been so bad and he didn't expose all your skeletons and tell you to repent and tell you he loves you. And next thing you know, you say, I'm a Christian. I'm a born-again Christian. I'm saved. But the founder told us, listen, I'm down. Your salvation was accomplished right here before the creation came in. Why? Because this is the lamb that is slain before the foundation of the world. This is the sacrifice that came to come from behind the veil of inscrutability. And this is how you were saved long before you came in, long before Adam came in. Your salvation was already set up. The problem is that you didn't know it. Hallelujah.
We want to truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this morning. And we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30, Sunday morning from 11 to 1. The fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45.
9:15.
All donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lloyd Lawless. And you have any announcements? Any announcements? No announcements? So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies and stand for the doxology. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah. I lost my book bag, so I'm trying to slowly build up my collection again.
It's not a bad book.
I like it because it was large print, is why I grabbed it this morning.
All right. Yeah, see? See what it says? It takes the power out of it. It says, "A smart life creates joy, it was not from time and peace, and fear of man." You don't say evil. And see, that's how I gave you, they got read by the power. You see, because see, if they change the word calamity, it's chaos, like that, you know, the trouble.
But they neglected the fact that it is.
But when you say evil, it gives it just a little bit more power. You see, or it says this here, over in John 8:44. I always go to certain places when I pick up the Bible. John 8:44, and John just says, Did I not choose 12 years and one of you did that? So I like that. So you just need to change it from calamity to evil.